YouTube and Facebook and other social outlets. We appreciate you spending time with us in the Word. God bless you. Once you found Matthew 25, why don't you signify by saying amen?
Amen.
If by chance you have not found it, you are still looking, say, wait a minute. Praise God. Being as though we're all on accord, we are all there. Let us look at 25 and drop down to verse 31 as we read the Word together. Matthew 25, verse 31 reads as follows. When the Son of Man comes in his glory, and all the holy angels with him, then he will sit on the throne of his glory, and the nations will be gathered before him, and he will separate them one from another, as a shepherd divides his sheep from the goats. And he will set the sheep on his right hand, but the goats on the left. The king will say to those on the right hand, come, you blessed of my Father, inherit the kingdom prepared for you from the foundation of the world. For I was hungry, and you gave me food. I was thirsty, and you gave me drink. And I was a stranger, and you took me in. I was naked, and you clothed me. I was sick, and you visited me. I was in prison. You came to me. Righteous will answer him, saying, Lord, when did we see you hungry and feed you? You or thirsty and gave you drink? When did we see you a stranger and take you in? Or naked and clothe you? Or when did we see you sick or in prison and come to you? The king will answer and say to them, assuredly I say to you, inasmuch as you did it to one of the least of these, my brethren, you did it to me. Then he will also say to those on the left hand, depart from me, you cursed, into the everlasting fire, prepared for the devil and his angels. For I was hungry, and you gave me no food. I was thirsty, and you gave me no drink. I was a stranger, and you did not take me in. I was naked, and you did not clothe me. Sick and in prison, and you did not visit me. Then they also will answer, saying, Lord, when did we see you hungry or thirsty or a stranger or naked or sick or in prison and did not minister to you? And he will answer them, saying, as surely I say to you, inasmuch as you did not do it to one of the least of these, you did not do it to me. And these will go away into everlasting punishment, but the righteous into eternal life. I want to put a tag on today's text, and I want to use this as a topic and a title for our sermonic exchange, Kingdom Principles. Kingdom. Matter of fact, I'm changing that. Kingdom Priorities. Amen. Kingdom Priorities. You may be seated in the presence of our Lord and our King. Kingdom Priorities. In this gospel, more specifically, in this pericope, what we read is Jesus sharing some words about what has been and could be referred to as the judgment discourse. What will take place on judgment. He's giving an example, he's giving some analogies, he's giving some perspective on what would take place and or how it will be perceived. He's giving some very specific stories and analogies. And in this particular 25th chapter, what we see is he gives three analogies, three examples, three stories, three points of reference. The first one is he talks about the foolish brides who were unprepared. Five were unprepared, five were unprepared, and they missed, bless you, the bridegroom, and therefore it was used as a message and a warning to be ready because we do not know when the Son of Man shall return. The second example and or analogy or point of reference that he uses, he talks about the foolish man who wasted the talents that God had given. Of course, he's talking about kingdom here, and as the man that he gave talents to him. He did not bring back a profit. He did not invest it. Instead, he hid it, wasted it. This is the second example. The third example and or analogy, a point of reference, a story that he uses, is what would take place on the day of judgment in this judgment discourse. He talks about how there will be the separation of the sheep and the goat. And the sheep will be put on one side and the goat on the other side. And then, of course, the goat would be sent to an everlasting damnation and be sentenced to eternal death, if you will. He separates the goat from the sheep. We know, of course, he's talking about and making reference to the saved and unsaved, the sheep of God, if you will, the disciples of God, the children of God. He's making that separation. Those who don't have faith in Jesus Christ, those who are not redeemed and have covenantal relationship, will be cast into the eternal pit. He separates the sheep from the goat. And on that day, that's what God will do. He'll separate those who accepted Christ and those who did not accept Christ. Those who did not accept Christ and do not accept Christ, while yet they have life and have breath inside of them, they will be banished to everlasting eternal damnation. The children of God, the sheep, those who have faith, those who have relationship, will be invited to partake in eternal bliss, if you will, eternal salvation. But as he gives these examples, and as he makes reference, if you will, to this discourse, my brothers and my sisters, there's a few things that I notice that kind of stand out to me and for me as priorities. And I notice also God's method of operation. It's a certain way that God does things. Mm-hmm. It's a certain way when he's trying to accomplish something, when he's trying to reveal his glory and or his deity. When he is trying to make himself known in the earth, when he is trying to establish relationship and or he's trying to mark the line in the sand, if you will, to distinguish himself as the capital G God from the lower G gods, lowercase G gods, and show that he is distinct in the category all by himself, that he is the one and the true living God. And God does things that he is trying to communicate in or trying to impart. He has a certain method or mold in which he does those things. And I want to suggest to you, and I want to submit, maybe this is not an exhaustive list, but for the purposes of our exchange today, I want to suggest there's at least three different ways that he does it. Number one, it's through messengers. Amen. Number two, it's through miracles. Amen. But number three, it's through ministry. Amen. And I'm going to touch upon the first two just a little bit, but I want to spend majority of my time, and I promise you I won't take a whole lot of time today, but I want to spend most of my time, I want to put the anchor down, amen, on ministry. And talk a little bit about ministry in the context of what we ought to be doing, what we should be doing, what we could be doing. So let me back up and hurry up and get to this. So first of all, one of his methods of operation or his modes of operation is through messengers. Throughout the ages, God has used human personality and voices to communicate his truths. He's raised up prophets who would go forth and declare what thus saith the Lord.
Amen.
And we've seen all throughout the Hebrew scriptures, what we refer to as the Old Testament, we've seen individuals such as the minor prophets and the major prophets. We've seen Joel, and we've seen, Jeremiah, and we've heard from Moses and Abraham and all of these mighty men of God, even through the efforts of King David as a king and all these great voices that God used to communicate his truths, to either warn people, amen, of what would come and or to pronounce blessings upon them and or to pronounce curses when people disobeyed and lived in disobedience and defiance. It was through human personality. It was through messengers. And I don't know about you, brothers and sisters, but I am excited to know that God uses messengers.
Amen.
One of the reasons why I'm excited that God uses messengers is because we are those messengers.
Amen.
From various capacities, whether you're a prophet, whether you're a pastor, whether you're a priest, or whether you're people. Amen. Common people, laity. God uses personalities. He uses humans. He uses messengers. And when we really think about it, God does not have to use us. I said this in my opening statements, my welcoming statements this morning. God does not have to use us. He chooses to use us. And for that, you ought to be grateful. Amen. You ought to be thankful that he chooses to use you,
even though you and I
are not worthy to be used.
Thank you.
He makes up for the difference. He makes up for the lack. He makes up for the slack. He uses us. And please, my brothers and my sisters, don't let the enemy confuse you that even though we're not worthy, God still sees something valuable in us.
Amen.
Yes, he does. And here's the humbling reality. Lest we puff ourselves up, because, you know, man sometimes can get the big head. Puff himself up and think, you know, I'm all that in a bag of chips and a side of dip, you know, and we think that we are indispensable and we think that we are irreplaceable. Amen. Almost again, irreplaceable. You think that you can't replace me. Amen. You'll never find another me. You run around, got Beyonce as your theme song or what have you. Oh, don't get it twisted, baby Bobby. You can be replaced. Yes, you can. Just as God moved you in, God can move you out. Just as God raised you up, God can tear you down. Just as God put you in office, he can take you out of office. He can use anybody. Yes, he can. Oh, don't get it twisted. You may have a great voice that can sing, amen, or preach the horns off of Billy Goat. But God can still use someone else. Yes, he can. So when you walk around thinking, I'm the only one that can do it. And see, that's, let me just pause parenthetically. That's one of the problems that we have in the local church. Is that people, they try to take hostage certain positions in the church and certain responsibilities because they don't want nobody else to do it. They want to be solely responsible. They want to be so important. That's my job. Some people are in position, have been in position since Jesus left. And don't plan on leaving from position until he comes back.
Come on.
But people who have wisdom understand there are cycles to these things. And there are seasons. And you serve your season, and then you pass the baton on to someone else. But during your season, you serve faithfully. And during your season, you pour into someone else so you can raise them up so they can take the baton and continue on. It's not about you. It's about the kingdom. And when you understand it's about the kingdom, you don't make it about yourself. And therefore, you gladly share responsibility, and you gladly share your knowledge. You gladly share your wisdom. You gladly share your gifts, and you pass it on. You don't hawk it, and you don't keep it to yourself.
Come on, Pastor.
So if you're going to have a healthy church, you got to have a church that is willing to impart and willing to invest. And if you don't, then you will not have a healthy church, and you will not have a church that thrives, nor a church that stays alive. Because the moment you die, the moment that ministry dies, the moment you are no longer able or no longer want to do what it is that you're doing, then no longer will that ministry, will that particular job and function be fulfilled. And that ought not be so. Amen, somebody.
Amen.
And so we ought to find ourselves in a position where we share it, we pass it on. It's not about one specific person. But it's so good to know that God does use messengers. And it's so good to know that despite our shortcomings and inadequacies, he still chooses to use us. I'm so imperfect.
Thank
yes,
you.
I am. I got flaws. Don't look at me like that, because so do you. But guess what? God looks beyond our faults and he sees our needs. And watch this.
Thank you, Father.
While we were yet sinners, he died for us. So he knew we were sinners. That's why he came in the first place, to pay the penalty for our sins. And he knew we were sinners when he died. He knew we were sinners when he rose again. And he knew we were sinners when he saved us. And he knew that we would never be perfect in and of ourselves. But he still chooses to use us. I need to say that to somebody, because somebody is allowing their imperfections to prevent them from being used by God. Well, God, surely you can't use me because I got too many skeletons in my closet. God, surely you can't use me. I got too many secrets. I got too many things going on. You know, one of the greatest excuses that people use is, well, you know, when I get my life right. When I get things in order, then I'll give it a try. If you can get it right, then you wouldn't need God.
Amen.
And if you don't wait until you get it right, then you'll never do it.
Preach, God.
So my brothers and my sisters, God can use. So we're not, irreplaceable. We are replaceable. Yes, we are. But understand this: God does not have to use us because if He wanted to, do you know that He could cause that every time the birds chirp? Do you know that He could use the chirping of the birds as a means and a method to communicate the gospel? So instead of hearing chirp, 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 you could hear, "For God so loved the world that He gave His only begotten Son, that whosoever believes in Him shall not perish but have everlasting life." Chirp, 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 chirp. Do you know that any time that the thunder rolls and we hear the boom in the sky, that instead of hearing the boom, what we could hear is a voice that says, "For the wages of sin is death, but the gift of God is eternal life." We can hear the gospel communicated through the thundering. Or maybe you watch this. When the lightning flashes in the sky, instead of being blinded by the brightness of the light, maybe we would just see scriptures and words from the Bible all in the sky. God can use the thunder. He can use lightning. He can use birds. He can use anything. He does not have to use you. He does not have to use me. He chooses to.
Amen.
Thank you. God uses messengers. Not only has God used messengers, God uses miracles. Jesus didn't perform miracles just to show off. You know, I don't normally do this, but keep the party going. It wasn't just a show. I got a new magic trick. Let me show you what I got up under my sleeve. Y'all remember Bullwinkle? When Bullwinkle was saying, some of y'all got that. That's what dates you. It really dates you. But Bullwinkle would roll up his sleeves and said, "I got another trick." Where? Up under my sleeve. Or he would reach into that hat and pull out a rabbit out of his hat, you know, all that stuff. Or pull it. Yeah, y'all remember, don't you? If you don't know, if you don't remember, Google it. Amen. This is back when cartoons were cartoons. Just stuff y'all watch nowadays, I don't know what it is. But Google Bullwinkle. That was some good stuff. I love Rocky and Bullwinkle. Little flying squirrel. What the squirrel did it fly? And all that stuff. Yeah, anyway. There's that rabbit he's chasing. Y'all made me go there. What point was I making? So anyway. So the miracles is not Jesus just trying to show off and say, "Look what I can do." Mm-hmm. It's not Jesus. Listen, when you think about the two fish and the five loaves of bread, that was a pretty good trick, if you will. But it wasn't about Jesus trying to do a trick or perform, you know, something to impress. Jesus was meeting needs. Mm-hmm. That miracle was an instrument by which God used. I told you He uses various modes and or methods and or mechanisms to do what it is that He wants to do and to accomplish His will. And so when He did the two fish and five loaves of bread and He fed the multitude, it wasn't to impress people. It was to meet the needs of people. He was able to feed. Because remember what happened. The disciples says, "Hey, these folks been here all day. They're hungry. What shall we do?" One of the disciples said, "Send them home." Ain't our responsibility, ain't our business. Send them home. Amen. We can't feed all these people. Let them eat at home. Jesus said, "No. We ain't gonna send them home hungry. We gonna feed them." He said, "Well, we gonna feed them with Jesus. We ain't got no money. I'm broke. See, the way my bank account is set up, you know, I'm broke. We ain't got no food. All we got," he was being smart, being funny, "all we got is the little boy's sack lunch, two fishes, and five loaves of bread. That's all we got." Jesus said, "That's more than enough." And it was through that miraculous work that He fed the multitude. Miracles. Opening up blinded eyes was not just because He was trying to be healthcare. I'm your healthcare. Open up your eyes. You know, I'm your healthcare. Open up deaf ears. It was not about that. What it was is He was doing, using miracles to bring about the purpose of God.
Amen.
And to show God's glory and to open up the door so He can communicate the gospel truths.
Amen.
That's what miracles were all about. Okay, I mean, think about this, y'all. When he raised Lazarus from the dead, Lazarus was a living, breathing testimony, a living, breathing, walking miracle, was he not?
Amen.
But Lazarus died again. Lazarus eventually died again. He lives however many years he lived, and he died again. It was not to show that I am, you know, got all these powers and what have you. It was because he was using it as a mechanism to bring about a greater glory, and or to use it as a mechanism to prove a point and to reveal his glory. All these things. He did it, my brothers and my sisters, for those purposes. And that's what God does. He uses messages and he uses miracles. But then thirdly and lastly, here's where I'm going to spend the last 2 minutes. Is on ministry and through ministry. It is through ministry. These are kingdom priorities. Mm-hmm. These are kingdom priorities. And he says, it's so important to me and therefore ought to be important to you that not only am I making reference to it, it's really going to be on the agenda come judgment day. And I don't know about you, but I think that I would want to know what God is going to be looking at and what God is going to be looking for, and the rubrics and matrix in which God is going to be evaluating me. I think I want to know that. Wouldn't you want to know that? Mm-hmm. On judgment, what it is that you're going to, what is it that you're going to use to evaluate and or to grade me? He says, here it is right here. It's ministry. It's the ministry. Remember, I've taught you in several times and occasions that salvation is not brought about through works. We don't work to get saved. We save because we work. We work because we're saved. Amen. So now that we are saved, what is it that we ought to be doing? What are some of the things that ought to be a part of our everyday lives and everyday makeup? What is it? What's priority? Priority is ministry. Let me give you a definition of ministry. If you're taking notes, you might want to write this down. Here's the definition of ministry. The definition of ministry is, watch this, identifying needs.
Amen.
And then meeting those needs to the point that the needs are no longer needs. Preach, Pastor Sanders. Amen. I got an amen in the back. Amen. Identify needs and then meet those needs to the point that those needs are no longer needs. And guess what that means? That means that ministry is ongoing. Uh-huh. That means ministry is continuous. While yet we may do outreaches that are a one-time pop, you're going to do something one time, you encounter people that you may never encounter again and what have you, that's fine too, but true ministry and context in the life of the church is whereby we are concerned about meeting needs. And so if the church is not identifying needs within its immediate context and then within its greater context, if it's not identifying needs and then working to meet those needs and working to meet those needs where we have eliminated the needs, you see, because it's like this, we can go out and give people fish and they'll eat and they'll be satisfied. And if they eat the KFC special fish, not Kentucky, but Cornelia and Friends of Christ, they eat that fish, they're going to be real happy. But guess what? In a couple of hours, they're going to be hungry again. And that's fine because we'll sell some more, you know, because starting, you know, next week we'll have noonday options and evening options. You can get it on the way from work, amen, on your way home, what have you. But anyway, once you meet that need, it's a temporary need. I have to throw that shame in. But once you meet that need, there will be the need created all over again. It's not resolved. So give a man a fish, you eat for the day, or eat for the afternoon, eat for the moment. But if you teach him how to fish, he'll be satisfied for the rest of his life.
Amen.
Because now he knows how to continue to meet that need. Yes, he knows how to sustain himself. And that's what ministry is that we are eliminating needs and solving and resolving problems, and or we're empowering people, or we're setting up a mechanism where people will be and shall be taken care of. So an example of empowering people maybe would be helping folk who are in financial straits. It's okay to pay the light bill phone, but guess what? If they have not corrected their financial issues, then they'll need their light bill paid again the following month, and the following month, and then after that it'll be the gas bill. And this was, so why not just teach them financial management? Why not help them in the area of their career? Maybe getting a better job, or helping them to get a raise, or whatever the case may be, because now we're solving issues, and we're resolving matters, and we're empowering them. But an instance where the church would maybe continue to meet needs, and say, for example, with our seasoned saints. As they have pioneered and they've labored and helped the church to move forward and what have you, and now in their golden years and they're in chill mode, you know, the church ought to now find ways of helping to sustain and take care of them.
Amen.
Amen. Including this church, as we have seasoned saints. So we find ways to help support and undergird them. For example, you can't expect, even though I've known people to do it, you can't expect someone in their 90s to be out shoveling snow and cutting grass, though I've known someone to do it. Y'all know, I know a little old lady. She's passed, going on wherever she's gone now. Amen. But she was in her 90s and was blind, legally blind, though somehow she found some way to get around. She saw a little bit. Not too much. She was legally blind and partially deaf. And you know, this little lady worked harder than some of these 20-some year olds. And I mean for real, for real.
Come on.
But for the most part, you don't expect someone in their 80s and 90s to be out there shoveling that snow. Even though she did, shoveling snow, cutting grass, down her hands and knees, manicuring her grass, and all of that. But that's where saints and other people come in and say, you know what, that's how I met her. Saw her out there, and I just, in my good conscience, couldn't I just let this little old lady just out there, you know, shovel snow and all that. And that's how I met her. Before you know it, I got sucked in doing something that everybody knows. I really hate shoveling snow. I do not like it. But I couldn't let that little lady be out there shoveling snow. And I found myself kind of in the situation that while I'm shoveling snow and I don't remember if I cut the grass, and I think she has some idea. But anyway, the whole point is this. We ought to come alongside and support. That's an example of the church undergirding and providing ongoing ministry. Amen. Y'all hear what I'm saying?
Come on.
That's what ministry is. Identifying needs, meeting the needs to the point that the needs are no longer needs. And what Jesus does, he gives us a few examples of some of those priority ministry outlets and objectives when he says, hey, you have amongst you folk who are naked. And you walking around in your meat coats. Your tailor-made suits. Tailor-made dresses. Your Louis Vuittons. Walking so everybody can see your red bottles. Standing like this so everybody can see you got on Louis Vuittons. Walking around with Louis Vuitton and Gucci and Prada. And you got your Michael Kors and all that. You walking around, you fancy, huh? There's some folk over there naked. And he says, hey, I got an idea. Why don't you clothe the naked?
Amen.
Why don't you make certain that the naked have something to put on their bodies? What about those who are sick? Why don't you find a way of bringing some sense of relief or comfort or peace or joy to those who were sick and shut in? Maybe what Christ is also suggesting and recommending that the church ought to be a voice for health care. So we advocate on behalf of health care, and in our current administration where a particular health care plan is being overturned and overhauled and what have you, maybe we ought to have a voice in that matter and say, hey, consider this. And consider these people when you are considering health care. We got to make certain that people's needs are taken care of and their health matters. No one should have to live their life without having appropriate medical attention. So maybe this is an opportunity where God says, speak on a bigger platform as it relates to policies and what have you, but also make certain you look after those folk who are sick and shut in and have nobody else to care for them. He says, this is what's priority to me. As a matter of fact, he uses himself as an example. He says, when I was sick, you didn't come and see about me. He said, when I was naked, you didn't clothe me. When I was thirsty and hungry, you didn't meet my needs. The church ought to be a voice for eliminating hunger and homelessness. But the church also ought to be an extension to address the needs of those who are homeless and hungry and thirsty. That's why our church in times past has created pantries in Africa. On any given Sunday, we would give away free groceries. You come to church and after service, you walk away with a box of groceries. Unannounced. Just meeting needs. And some of the people would come back and say, "Pastor, we needed those groceries. We were so short on funds and on food. We didn't know what to do. And all of a sudden, here's these free groceries. Thank you, Pastor." And feeding children after school programs. All these things are examples of us meeting needs, feeding folks. That's what the church ought to be about. Are y'all hearing what I'm saying to you? But not only did he say, when I was hungry, when I was thirsty, when I was naked, and when I was in the hospital and whatever, he says in prison. Oh, maybe what God is saying here, not only should we have prison ministry, but we ought to have a voice as it relates to prison reform, and as it relates to criminal justice, and as it relates to restorative justice, and as it relates to double standard sentencing, and as it relates to DMC, disproportionate minority contact, and disproportionate minority convictions. Maybe we ought to have a voice when we have a modern day mechanism where people are being enslaved. Because that's what it is. When you take a population and there's an overrepresentation in the prison system, and when you have privatization where people own prisons and therefore are benefiting from prisons, something is wrong, and the church ought to say and do something about it. Preach, Pastor Sanders.
Amen.
These individuals are rotting away in prison, as prisons are not rehabilitative, prisons are not restorative, prisons are warehousing, human warehousing, and the church must say something and do something about it. Yeah. It's wonderful, it's great to go into the prisons and have church and sing Kumbaya and have altar calls and feel good about yourself because people heard the gospel and people gave their life. That's wonderful. But what about when they get out? What about as we try to thank you, help them, and keep them from getting in? As they're standing before the judge, we need to speak on behalf of laws that are being made, legislation that is being introduced that is sending our people to jail for a long, long time. All because people are making dollars. $30,000, $60,000+ a year per bed. That's big business. Church, kingdom, ought to say something about it. It's a priority that we ought to have. And he says, when I was in prison, you didn't say nothing about it. When I was in prison, you were silent when it came to my needs and when it came to my issues. And he says, I need for you to be a voice, and I need for you to be my hands. And he says, if you don't do it, you've disregarded me, and you've disrespected me, and you've disappointed me. Because he says, because they come back and they say, "Well, Lord, when were you home?"